As you can see, Thomas Barr joins me now. Thomas, how are things?
Not too bad at all.
It seems things are going pretty well for you at the moment. Every time I Google your name, it's like a new personal best, a new season best for Thomas Barr. That curve is rightly on the way up.
Yeah, so far it's been good. Like, the season was a bit of a slow burner, but it's starting to kind of come into good stead now, just at the right time.
Because there was a few niggling injuries at the start of the season, the start of the outdoor season anyway.
I actually was injury free. It was just, I was trying to find rhythm. I just couldn't get things going. You know, I was quite fast over the first 200 of the race, but then the final 200 I was kind of dropping off. So I had a chat with my coach and we kind of said, right, we need to go out a bit more relaxed, run more like I used to run, sort of. But I was kind of, we were kind of thinking, it's really since Rio that I've had a full fast run, fast race, really. So it was just trying to find that rhythm, and yeah, we found it again.
You were running over 200 last night.
Yes, yeah, I dropped down in the distance at a half day yesterday.
Yeah. And what's the thought process behind that? It's just rhythm, it was just the best available opportunity there?
Yeah, so basically, like, at the moment now, we kind of have the hard work done, the 400 work is done, so we were just trying to work on speed, really.
Okay.
So the last week or so has been based on trying to work on speed, and then basically wanted to just do a 200 in Cork just for a bit of crack, and I was way out of my depth. I was out the gap. I was watching the race as much as I was taking part from behind, and I was thinking halfway through, or not halfway, but about 50 meters to go, I was like watching Marcus Lawler. I was like, either Marcus is running a stormer here, or I am running like a donkey.
He was running a stormer.
Yeah. So because he was so far ahead, and then I ended up coming home with a PB as well. So I was happy with that. Yeah, it was a good run.
Good night's work down in Cork last night.
Absolutely.
It's weird, isn't it? Because you think about people jumping up the distances, and the obvious problem is they don't have the legs for it. But dropping down must be a weird one, because you obviously have the legs for it. It must be kind of a weird one of almost not pacing yourself, but saying, listen, the way I'm conditioned to pace myself actually is completely different when I'm running a 200.
It's completely different, yeah. Because, like, even my start, you know, my start, say, for the first 50 metres, I don't think I changed it, which I needed to. I didn't get out probably hard enough last night. But it is good that I know the speed is there, and I know I can comfortably go out over the first 200 now in the 400 hurdles quite quickly and comfortably.
Your preparation for the Europeans has been quite interesting. I wanted to chat to you about Oslo and the situation at the Diamond League meeting there. Do you want to explain to people who missed that what happened around Oslo?
Okay, so basically I had a meet in Finland, I think it was, and I had run okay. I hadn't run as well as I would have hoped. I landed home, landed into Dublin. I was staying with my girlfriend in Dublin last night, that night, thankfully. And I got a phone call basically from my agent just to say, do you want to race in the Diamond League in Oslo? And, like, the Diamond League is the premier league of athletics, you know, you don't turn it down. So I was like, yeah, brilliant. Okay, you're on a, and this was at 10 o'clock at night. He's like, okay, you're on a flight tomorrow, so at 11 in the morning. And I was like, right, okay, I need to just literally pick myself up, turn myself around, didn't get any washing done, literally barely had time for a shower, went to sleep, up the next day, straight back out, landed into Oslo at about probably 4 or 5 p.m. Their time, got to the hotel, got a small bit of food, straight to the track, warmed up, and straight out and ran the race.
Then you had time to edit the Instagram, on Instagram, the little start list as well, to get your name in there.
Yeah, I had just enough time to do that in the airport.
Yeah, it went pretty well for you. Like, it's such an interesting element of it, because it's something that we're not used to seeing, because we're used to seeing just you representing Ireland. And as we were just saying off air, it's even strange to see you running without the Irish singlet on, or without the Irish uniform on. And it's a whole other element to athletics that I guess we're not watching all that time in Ireland, but it is a huge market that we don't quite appreciate.
Yeah, that's it. I mean, we don't have that many athletes at the moment. Well, we do, I suppose, but there's not many that won't, you won't see as much, say, coverage of Irish athletes at major competitions other than the Europeans, Worlds, or Olympics, but the Diamond Leagues will be televised. They're the ones that you're going to see people at, and that was the one I was wearing my red and white New Balance kit. So that's what I wear all the way through the season until it comes to Nationals, where I'll wear my club singlet, and then Europeans, where I'll be wearing the back into the Irish kit again.
How do you get into that circuit? Is it just times by being one of the best, by having that unbelievable performance in Rio? Is that what got you into the Diamond League essentially?
Yeah, so like back in 2015 I became a regular on the Diamond League. I was in 5 or 6 of them that year, and basically it's just, I ran a fast time at the start of the season, got into the first Diamond League that year, ran well there, and then it was kind of a snowball effect, because I was in, you know, I was on the medal, or not on the medal, I was on the points board. I got invited then from then on, and I kept, you know, improving. Off the back of Rio, yeah, I could have performed, I could have taken part in any of them in 2017, really, that I'd wanted, but I unfortunately picked up a few injuries. And then, yeah, this year I got one invite and that was it. Hopefully I'll put down a faster time earlier in the season next year and I might get a couple more.
Yeah, it's interesting, isn't it? The whole peaking for the outdoor season. Like, you don't really ever get an opportunity as an athlete to winter well, so to speak. Yeah. There is no off season as such. No.
Yeah, I'll get like 4 weeks off in September, say this year. And then, yeah, it's just a really, really long pre-season, basically, is what it is.
And you've got to pick and choose the Diamond League meetings, for example. I think there's one in London this weekend. And like with the European Championships coming so close, it's almost like an unwanted friendly before the World Cup. It's like, actually, no, I want to train a little bit more, which I think you're going to select to do.
That's it. It is a bit of a toss-up. Like, I got a text there from my agent only about a half an hour ago to say, you know, if a lane came up in London Diamond League, would I take it? And I kind of, like, a big part of me wants to train, but then another part of me is saying, this is a Diamond League, it's another really good race to put down beforehand. But a big part of me is just wanting to train now for the next couple of weeks in the lead up to Nationals and then Berlin. I'll have to chat to my coach, he's the brains behind the operation.
Sure. What are the times like in the Diamond League at the moment? Have you noticed an appreciable difference in, say, the times in 2016?
Massive.
Really?
Absolutely massive this year. 400 meter hurdles in the Diamond League. 400 meter hurdles in general at the moment is on fire.
There's a guy called Samba from Qatar who I've seen is flying it.
He's running 47s like they're nothing. He's just doing them for fun at this stage, which is absolutely crazy. And then the Karsten Warholm, Norwegian guy, he's going to be in the Europeans. He's run low 48s consistently and even dipping into 47s. And then Capello, Turkish guy, he's running low 48s as well. So it's really Karsten Warholm and Yasmani Capello. They're the two that are, you know, consistently running really well on the circuit this year. So they're the big ones to look out for at the Europeans.
They're obviously brilliant athletes. But at the same time, there might be an element of them who are just ahead or in their training at this time of the season.
That's it.
Like, is that a difficulty when you look at those times and you're like, I kind of want to get a move on here. I want to up my times a little
Sometimes,
bit.
Sometimes, yeah.
Got to trust the process to a certain extent.
Exactly, I do. I trust the process. I trust my, like, Haley, my coach, is very good at having us peak for major championships. Mm. So, you know, I've done it year on year where even if I've had a haphazard year of training, I've still come out at the major championships and been able to put down a good performance. So hopefully the same again this year, but things are really starting to click this year. I've had a really good, consistent year of training. I'm only kind of coming into form now, but hopefully I'll bring the best form into the Europeans.
How big a deal is the Europeans? Does it give you an added incentive after being so unlucky in London in the World Championships?
Yeah.
Is it kind of like, right, next time really and truly the entire country will be watching, I guess, it will be the Europeans. Does that add anything to it, or is it just kind of like, it would have been massive anyway, you know?
Yeah, I mean, like, after London, I was extra hungry because I felt I had all this training done and banked and I didn't get to use any of it. Mm. But I kind of came into this year and I was like, right, okay, Europeans this year. Obviously, Europeans means that, you know, you don't have any of the Americans, you don't have, like, Samba, the Qatari, he's not going to be there. So it is a little bit softer, but it's still going to be tough this year. But it's the one championships really for the whole year that everybody tunes in for. So I'm really looking forward to it. Like, I base, most athletes will base their whole year around the major championships. So everything is geared towards this. So I'm looking forward to going out, being in shape, touch wood, I don't pick up any niggles between now and then, and giving it my best shot, and hopefully I'll be able to come home with something to shout about.
Absolutely, hopefully indeed. Just one other point on that, like you mentioned the focus on that one championships, and last time you had you in studio, I think it was about 6 months ago at this stage, like you were really impressive on talking about your focus on other things outside of the track.
Yeah.
So like, is there an element that's like, I kind of need to be completely invested in this athletics thing now again for another 6 months and then kind of dip back out to kind of, you know, getting involved in cars, doing your thing in UL, floating around, you know, but keeping your head in a good space, clearing the head out a little bit.
Yeah.
Has that changed at all, or are you still kind of dissecting your time a little bit?
Still floating around, yeah. No, I keep a good balance because, like, for me anyway, I like to train, and when I'm at training, I give it my 100%. But after that, then, I don't dwell on things. I don't like to overanalyze things too much, because that's when you start to, you know, too much negativity starts to creep in then. And like you said, trust the process. Like, I trust that when I'm at training that what I'm doing is right, or what I'm doing is right for what I need to be doing. So I trust my coach in that respect. So once I give it my 100%, I know that things will come right. So then after that, I like to switch off from athletics so that when I do come back to training again, I'm fresh for it. You know, I'm not constantly thinking about athletics all the time and overanalyzing anything. So I do like to still put my tentacles out in different directions.
Are those tentacles going in any new directions since the last time we've been chatting to you, or is it mostly cars in your spare time?
Cars, well, when the weather was nice there, I was out jet skiing and stuff. We're out on the lake and
boats. At home?
Yeah, but down in Limerick. A couple of my friends, we went out 1 or 2 days and just got out on the water. It was just it was unreal just to switch off for a while. I think we went out on a Sunday, had a day off training, so nice just to switch off.
Was your coach happy with that high chance of an injury there?
She didn't seem too unopposed to the idea anyway, or too opposed to the idea. I don't know which word I'm supposed to use there. So she was almost condoning the fact, I was happy enough.
Absolutely.
It keeps me happy, so if I'm happy, she's happy, I think.
That's the main thing. And I actually wanted to ask you just about this whole new generation of sprinters that have suddenly emerged in the public consciousness. I'm sure you've been well aware of them of quite some time, of especially the young women that are emerging in Ireland at under 18 and under 20 level. What advice would you give them in terms of that athletics and their own life balance?
It's been fantastic. For me, the one thing I would say is that they need to keep enjoying it. And that was the overriding factor for me when I was watching the interviews after and watching the reactions, and then even in interviews they were giving after that in newspapers and stuff. Everything seemed to be that they were enjoying the whole process. They were enjoying it all. None of their interviews were calculated. They were purely emotional. They were loving it, excited, which is the way it should be. It wasn't they got a medal and it was that was good, but we could do this and we could do this. It was just pure, we got a medal, this is amazing, let's enjoy it. And now it's just about basically nurturing that, keeping the foot on the gas, keep doing what they're doing and bring them on to the next level then. And it's a danger zone really for teenagers to drop out, especially moving through the later years in school and into college. So we need to keep them in the sport, bring you up through the senior ranks.
Yeah, the one struggle is for the public and for us in the media really is to keep our expectations in check a little bit, because straight away I'm thinking Tokyo and 2026 exactly. Olympics, medals left, right and centre,
That's it, yeah. Well, there's nothing stopping it. Hopefully, we will be able to bring them on to that level, bring them on to major championships, to European senior championships, world senior championships, and then Olympics, in 2020. It's really, really exciting to see such raw talent coming through once we can look after it and bring up through the ranks. It's really exciting to see that, especially for sprinting. Ireland isn't, and for me being a sprinter anyway, I'm obviously going to say that, but for sprinting in Ireland, it's not really a tradition of ours. So it's great to see the likes of the relay team absolutely powering through a world field.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, it's exciting times for yourself, and best of luck on the track. It'll be great to see you back in the Irish singlet this summer.
Thanks very much.